Welcome to the 1800s. It's a world of society balls, fancy gowns, cutting remarks, marriage plots. It must be another Jane Austen costume drama. But wait, not everything is as you might expect. Those dazzling dance scenes with sweeping orchestral covers of Ariana Grande and Taylor Swift. And fireworks? Acrobats? That's a very good-looking cast. I don't remember a duel in Pride and Prejudice, and oh my goodness, are they having sex? Bridgerton has arrived on Netflix. It's made by Shondaland, that's Shonda Rhimes' production company, which means that Bridgerton has all the high-stakes drama, low-down plotting, and intense intrigue, which has made Shondaland's other shows like Grey's Anatomy and How to Get Away with Murder so very, very compelling.
Never take a learning opportunity away from another student. No matter how smart, you need everyone to think you are.
But while previous Shondaland dramas have had a contemporary and American setting, Bridgerton takes place in England 200 years ago, and it's all based on one of the most popular series of novels that you may never have read. So, here is the story behind Bridgerton. Author Julia Quinn published her first novel in 1995 at the age of 24. She now has almost 40 titles to her name. There are 10 million of her books in print in the United States alone.
You say that as if reading were a bad thing.
Her novels have been translated into a staggering 32 languages. In the UK, she's one of the most borrowed adult authors from libraries.
The pages report nothing but the truth, Lady Featherington.
But unless you read romance, you're unlikely to have come across her. That's because romance, despite being wildly popular, doesn't get taken seriously.
Put down that book at once. You shall confuse your thoughts.
As Quinn told Time magazine, you always get more respect when you don't have a happy ending. And one thing you can count on in a romance novel is that there will be a happy ending. In some ways, romance novels had earned their bad reputation by the time Quinn started writing them in the 90s. The caricature of them as stories of delicate heroines pursued by large and brooding men until they were finally brought into submission wasn't actually that far from the mark. But Quinn, a Harvard graduate and briefly a Yale medical student, wanted to do things differently. You can even see her savviness in her name. Quinn is a pen name. She chose it because it would mean her books were shelved alongside another successful romance author in bookshops. Her novels are notable for their rounded characters, snappy dialogue, and yes, quite a lot of sauciness, all delightfully consensual. I can't think of anything in any of my books that any feminist would find objectionable, she said. Since Splendid arrived in 1995, which became the first part of a trilogy, Quinn has created several series of novels, all in the same genre. There's the Bevelstoke series, the Smythe-Smith Quartet, and one called Agents of the Crown. But Bridgerton is the biggest series by far. There are 11 Bridgerton titles, and even more if you count the spin-off series The Rokesbys. The stories center, as you might imagine, on the noble Bridgerton family, headed up by Matriarch Violet. Father Edmund has died 10 years before the first novel begins, leaving Violet with 8 children to raise, including 4 daughters who will all need to be married off. Eldest son Anthony has inherited the title Viscount from his father.
Do not bring father into this.
Making him eminently eligible, but unfortunately for the marriageable young women of the ton, that's Regency speak for respectable society, he's also incorrigibly rakish. Next, there's Benedict, whose artistic and sensitive nature leaves him yearning for more than superficial rounds of ball going and making calls.
Are you to tell me you're not an artist yourself?
Well, I suppose sometimes I like to.
Then there's Colin, the charming one with the irresistible wit.
I did not know you would be here.
Sorry to disappoint.
You might have realised by now that yes, the Bridgerton children are all named in alphabetical order. As Anthony acknowledges in the first book, this makes them difficult to forget.
She loathes the fact that we've been named alphabetically, oldest to youngest.
Father and I found it orderly.
Lady Whistledown. Banality.
Eloise Bridgerton is the family rebel, determined to avoid the conventional fate of the respectable young lady.
You must make haste!
Should you think she heard me?
The reserved and watchful Francesca comes next. Her introverted nature sets her apart from her siblings, but conceals a sly and pointed sense of humour. Gregory is the classic annoying little brother, and Hyacinth is the baby of the family, looking up to her sisters and looking forward to following them into the world. What happened to Dee? That's Daphne, eldest daughter and the centre of Series 1 of Bridgerton.
Miss Daphne Bridgerton!
Being the first girl in the family means that she must also be the first to get married. Until she's taken, convention dictates that her sisters will have to wait their turn. As the star of her cohort of debutantes, making a good match should be easy for Daphne, but she's unwilling to settle for a third-rate or even second-best suitor.
You and I were destined for each other.
And even her affectionate and supportive mother is in danger of running out of patience when Bridgerton begins. Enter Simon, the reluctant and very handsome Duke of Hastings. Reluctant because tense relations with his domineering father have left him determined to do anything other than follow in the paternal footsteps. His friendship with Antony leads to a meeting with Daphne, which leads in turn to sparks flying between the headstrong pair. But before anything can happen, there are, of course, some complications. Some of those complications are brought about by the mysterious Lady Whistledown. That's the pseudonym used by the author of a scandal sheet which keeps every family in society in fear of their reputation, and keeps them all hanging on its every word, eager for the scurrilous details. Think of Whistledown as the OK magazine of the Regency era, or a kind of Twitter before Twitter. Lady Whistledown is really the genius stroke of the Bridgerton novels, giving Quinn a clever way to fill out her storytelling and power the plot.
Enough about Lady Whistledown.
It's also a strikingly modern detail. And bearing in mind that Quinn started writing the books long before social media became a ubiquitous presence in all our lives, a very prescient one. But it's also a sly tribute to the literature of the time when Bridgerton is set. Letters, and their potential for stirring up trouble or being misunderstood, show up constantly in 18th and 19th century novels. And while no one would look to Jane Austen for smut, there's an undeniable undercurrent of bad behaviour in her stories. Think of the rebellious Lydia's elopement with the disgraceful Mr. Wickham in Pride and Prejudice.
Oh, Lydia, you will write to me often, won't you?
And if you want saucier than that, there were always the works of Henry Fielding or Daniel Defoe, which were certainly not fit for the eyes of young ladies. All of which means that Julia Quinn's Bridgerton is the perfect 21st century take on a classic literary tradition, and Shondaland the perfect partner in bringing it to the screen. Find out for yourself by watching Bridgerton Series 1 on Netflix this Christmas, and subscribe to this channel to get more great videos about upcoming Netflix shows.